اطمئن. اما بعد, السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Sheikh Muhammad, I wanted to talk to you today about three topics. The first, and probably the most important one, Sheikh Muhammad mentioned to me about the makeup of the group and about what type of people are here, and that these are, inshallah, the leaders for their respective parts of the Muslim community. So the first thing I wanted to discuss with you was something that I discussed with similar groups in London already, is leadership in Islam. This is fundamental. One of the things we all as individuals, whether we are leaders or future leaders or even just leaders of ourselves or our families, we all need to understand what is leadership in Islam. And why did I want to talk about this? I was invited on behalf of the British government to a leadership conference hosted by KPMG, one of the big four consultancy companies, you might call them. And in this leadership conference, they paid, I'm not going to tell you the figure, a ridiculous amount of money to bring the world's leadership expert. So this guy came, I won't tell you his name. This guy came. They flew him from Zimbabwe. And he claims to be the world's leadership expert. So they gathered all of the senior leadership of the British government and some people from the private sector. And he was going to tell us about what he learned from 24 years of studying leadership. This guy's devoted his entire life to nothing but leadership. He studied great leaders. He went around the world. He spoke to religious leaders. He spoke to political leaders. He spoke to all these leaders. And he came to give us his wisdom. What was his hikmah? What was his wisdom that he came to give us? I listened. Everybody in the audience, they were sitting like this. What are you going to say? As though it's wahi, revelation. Like Jibreel alayhi salam has come down and is giving this man wahi to tell us about leadership. And they were listening. And they were writing and writing and writing. I sat and I listened and I concluded one thing. I'll tell you three conclusions, but the first one is this. It took him 24 years of studying leaders to recognize that the Quran and the Sunnah are the best way of leading. He didn't say this, wallahi. He didn't say in his Zimbabwe accent, you know, the best way is to lead according to Quran and Sunnah. He didn't say this. But everything he said, everything he taught us, which I'll show you in a moment, everything he gave us as leadership principles, we already know from the Quran and the Sunnah and the Seerah of Rasulullah SAW. Everything. The second thing I realized is that Allah grants levels of hidayah to anyone who is sincere. He hadn't come to Islam, but his striving for leadership, understanding, took him to the haqq. And the haqq that he came to is that everything he was teaching us was the example of Rasulullah SAW. Even though he's not Muslim. Because Allah granted, because of his sincerity, the ability to understand how we should lead. So what do we learn? And let's bring it down to Islamic leadership now. What do we learn? First thing he said, as a good leader, you have to ask the right questions. He said it's not about telling the people just what you want to tell them. It's about making sure you ask the right questions of yourself and of the people you lead. And I'm going to hold that for a moment. So keep this idea of asking the right questions in your mind. We're going to come back to that in a few minutes. The second thing he talked about was how a good leader, and all the leaders he studied in the world, he said one thing, they were always very positive with the people they led. He said, listen, when you look at good leaders, not dictators, good leaders, people who want to be led, people who respect the people who are leading them, people, and you know, Islamically, we judge the sheikh by the students. If the students are following the sheikh, mashallah, the sheikh must be doing something right. If you're opposing the sheikh, then there's something wrong here. So he said the good leader is the one who is positive with the people he leads. He's never harsh with them. He talks to them with kindness. He consults with them. Anything sound familiar here? I'm listening to this, and I wanted to stand up in the conference and say, you don't even realize that you are quoting the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. He says again, three times, he said the good leader, he's merciful towards his people. He's never harsh towards them. He consults with them, and that's how he brings them on board. Three times he mentioned this. Everybody wrote down and wrote down and wrote down. And I sat there, and suddenly the lights came on in my head. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, roughly translated, so by mercy from Allah, O Muhammad, alayhi salatu wasalam, you were lenient with them. Meaning what? Merciful with them. And if you had been harsh with them, then they would have turned away from you. So pardon them and ask forgiveness for them and seek shura with them, consult with them. And when you have decided, then rely upon Allah. Indeed, Allah loves those who rely upon Allah. Allahu Akbar. 24 years it took this man to develop the key to leadership, and the verse of the Quran taught us this straight away. We understand that we shouldn't be harsh with people. We should show them mercy, we should show them love, we should show them rahmah. Rasulullah has been sent as well, rahmatin lil alameen. Rahmatin lil alameen. Mercy for all of the worlds. So this mercy is what draws people towards you. Harshness only does one thing, it draws people away from you. No one wants to sit in a gathering with the shaykh shouting at them and telling them this and that. No, you want love, because this is the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is why we are drawn towards it. So the first thing I took from this leadership conference is the Quran and the Sunnah are right all along. We knew this anyway. As Muslims, we all know that the Quran and the Sunnah are the haq. But it took this guy 24 years to come to our conclusion. The next lesson he gave, the rest of the session was devoted to one thing. He said, the good leader is the one who is able to control his perceptions. You understand perceptions? Yeah? Is there a word more appropriate for perceptions? Everybody understands perceptions, right? Okay. He said, for example, this is him now, we'll bring it to Islam in a second. He said, for example, the good leader, when he looks at the people who are following him, when he looks at the issue in hand, when he looks at what he has to do, he perceives it in the correct way. Not according to his own desires, but according to what is the right outcome. Right. So we're talking about perceptions. So I started thinking, I'll be honest, I started drifting from what he said now. And I started thinking about the Quran and the Sunnah. Alhamdulillah, I get more ajr, I think, for thinking about Quran and Sunnah than what this Zimbabwe guy is saying. Perceptions. I kept thinking perceptions. He's saying about our perceptions. And I realized something. The greatest sins in Islam, if you think about it, the greatest sin a human being can commit, shirk, kufr, nifaq, hypocrisy, disbelief, associating that other than with Allah, these aren't done with your hand. These are done with your heart. This is a perception. The mushrik, the kafir, the munafiq, they perceive things wrongly. Let's take kufr for example. The kafir is not the people around us, necessarily. The kafir is the one who knows the truth, and he conceals it. So he perceives, whilst there is something there, he perceives he's going to live something differently to what he knows to be the truth. The munafiq is the one who pretends on the surface to be a good practicing Muslim, but actually inside his heart is disbelief and disobedience. This is perception. So the problem with perception is when we get it wrong, we get into trouble. But if we get it right, wallahi, some of the greatest achievements in Islam are done through our perceptions. We know about Ihsan, right? And we know that when Rasulullah, with the hadith of Jibreel, talks about Ihsan, and he said it is as though to worship Allah as though you see him. And whilst you don't see him, you know that he sees you, right? We all are familiar with the hadith of Jibreel. What does this mean? It means your perception. Because in real terms, okay, we say the Muslim is the one who performs his five basic pillars of Islam, right? The Salah, the Zakat, the Siyam, the Hajj, Shahada. This is the level of the Muslim. The Mu'min, the believer, tries to do more and more ibadah, right? So the Mu'min is the one striving to do as much as he can. But there's no difference between the Mu'min and the Muhsin in terms of the level of ibadah. The difference between the mu'min and the muhsin in terms of ibadah is how he sees it. Let me give you an example. One of the companions was having a conversation with one of the other companions one day. And he said, oh Mu'adh, tell me about your tahajjud, about your qiyam al-layl. He said, I go to sleep and then I wake up. I pray Isha, I go to sleep, I wake up, I pray qiyam al-layl. Then I sleep again. Then I wake up and I pray Fajr and Asr. But that's not the important bit. In this narration he says, but I believe, I have yaqeen, that Allah will reward me as much for my sleep as He does for my qiyam al-layl. How many of us, ask yourself, don't put your hand up, how many of us believe that when we go to sleep, we are gaining as much ajr for our sleep as we are for our qiyam al-layl? Think to yourself. If we're not, why not? Perception. The companion's perception was that his qiyam al-layl, my perception is I'm falling off the chair. The companion's perception was that the qiyam al-layl and the sleep had the same reward. Why? Because his niyyah for going to sleep was that when he goes to sleep, Allah refreshes him, gives him strength. Why? So that he can worship Allah. Now, if we can move this perception into everything of our life, wallahi, you can reach the level of ihsan. Because everything you do becomes ibadah. Everything. I'm going to ask you a question now. Hands up who like shopping. And I'm looking over here. Because I'm not going to look over here because everyone's going to say, yeah, I like shopping. Over here, who likes shopping? No one. Brothers. Really? Maybe this is a Holland thing. Men are like women. In England, men don't like shopping. Let's ignore these guys. In England, men don't like shopping. But I say to the brothers, when you go shopping, most brothers complain, oh, my wife, she takes 4 hours, she goes to 10 shops, and then we go back to the first shop and she chooses the thing she saw first. Every sister knows what I'm talking about. And every brother who's married knows what I'm talking about. I said, Akhi, if your perception of going shopping is that you're doing something for the sake of Allah, your wife enjoys it. It makes her happy. She needs to buy clothes, she needs to buy things, she needs to buy all of these things for the children, to make herself look nice, whatever it might be. If you perceive that you're going for the sake of Allah, that you're doing ithar, ithar is to prefer the other over yourself. You're doing ithar with your wives. That you prefer, they like shopping, so okay, you like shopping. You're doing this for the sake of Allah. Now shopping becomes ibadah. Right? Why? Because you're doing it for Allah. This is ihsan. And ihsan is a perception.
But how can you make shopping or the mistake or whatever? If I am the one who is going shopping, then how can I make the ibadah for myself?
Sure. Very good question. Very good question. How do you make that ibadah for yourself if you're the one who enjoys shopping? What's your niyyah for going shopping? Is it just to take time? Is it just to spend this? Is it to look at things? If you're near for going shopping, even as a woman or a man, it doesn't matter. Oh Allah, I need a new shirt to cover my aura. I need a shirt to make me look better. I need a shirt to keep me warm. Ya Allah, I know that Rasulullah said, the most beloved places to Allah on this dunya are the masajid of Allah. And I know the most hated places to Allah are the marketplaces. But Allah, I need to go to the marketplace to get the shirt. And I pray that inshallah you help me avoid all the fitna. But I'm doing it for your sake. Anything, wallahi, anything can be done for the sake of Allah. Husband-wife relationship. The companions were even shocked. Rasulullah said that you will be given reward for this. They were like, what? We're going to get reward for having marital relationships? He said, yes. Because if you do this in the haram way, will not Allah punish you? They said, yes. Therefore, when you do it in the halal way, Allah rewards you. That even something as wonderful as physical relationship, if your niyyah is that this is Allah giving you something in the halal way, which is pleasing to Allah and not displeasing to Allah, now you get reward for it. So perception, wallahi brothers and sisters, if our Muslim ummah and us as individuals and all of our families can start recalibrating our perceptions, everything changes in our lives. Everything. So there are a couple of things we've talked about. The greatest sins in Islam are perception. You can commit sin with your perception. Or you can reach the level of ihsan with perception. But I would say the most biggest challenge for all of us today in the modern world, in terms of our perception, is how to deal with the tests in life. This is the problem. I say this because Sheikh Mohammed may have mentioned, I have, as a volunteer, have to do a lot of nasiha People come to me with their problems. People come with their marriage problems, with their family problems, with all kinds of problems. So you listen to people's problems constantly. One of the things I took from this leadership conference about perception is that if we were able to change our perception of the difficulties in life, the tests of life, I can write to you almost like a written guarantee of happiness. That's a big statement, right? Everybody's saying that's a big statement. Some fat man from London has come along and he's telling me that. I'll back it up. If I say it for myself, you can throw it out the window. But if I bring to you evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah, the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that this is going to be the case, you can't challenge me, right? So we're going to speak for the next few minutes about this perception of test, about the life that we're living. First, before we go on, can I ask a question? Hands up anybody who's never had a test in their life. No one. Hands up anybody who's not suffering some test right now. Doesn't matter what it is. No one. And I could go in front of the whole of Netherlands, ask the same question, nobody will put their hand up. I can go in front of the whole of Europe, ask the same question, nobody will put their hand up. I can go in front of the whole world and say, is there anybody who has never suffered a test in their life? Is there anybody who is never suffering a test right now? No human being can put their hand up. No one. Why? Allah gives us the answer in the Quran. So let's look now at how we perceive the difficulties in our life. So first we acknowledge we're all facing difficulties. I don't need to know what it is. But I know everyone in this room, myself included, and every one of us has some difficulties in life. Let's look at what Allah says about these difficulties in the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, roughly translated, and you'll forgive me, I'm going to use English rough translations. If you want the Arabic, Sheikh Muhammad will give a better translation. Allah says, roughly translated, it is He who created death and life in order to test you. It is He, Allah, who created death and life in order to test you, which of you is best in deeds. And He is the exalted in might, oft forgiving. So the first thing we look now, Allah Himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is telling us in the Quran that He created death and life. Why? To test us, which is best in deeds. So when we come to the difficulties in life and our perception, number one thing we have to understand, Allah created this life as a place of test, as a place of difficulty. So we're told this is the purpose. One of the purposes of our creation is that we're going to be tested with this dunya. Why? Because the next life is the place of ease. You're going to get tested in this dunya, every one of us. Every one of us. But inshallah, if we are, according to this ayah, to test which of you is best in deeds, if we stay true to Allah, if we stay true to Islam, if we stay true to our Creator, inshallah, the next life, there is the life of happiness. What's the average age of the Ummah of Islam, of the Muslims? The average age that we die? Anyone know? 60. 60 is the average age of the Muslim Ummah. Some of us are closer than others. In this room, I'm probably closer to that age. But we don't know. We get 20 years, 30 years. Allah knows when life is coming. But the next life is eternity. Forever. So if we were asked with a sensible mind in a university setting, the professor says, you have an equation. 60 years, of which some of that time is going to be very difficult, versus eternity of happiness, which one are you going to choose? No one is going to say, I'm going to choose 60 years of happiness in exchange for eternity of happiness. No one. Even you ask a child, 5, 6 years old, which would you want? You want this toy for now, just for 5 minutes? Or you want this toy for the rest of your life? They'll say, I'll have it for the rest of my life. And yet, shaitan plays with our minds. And the dunya hugs us until we feel that this dunya is everything. So, first thing, Allah has told us that one of the purposes He created death and life for is to test us, which is best in deeds. Now imagine, if this test that you're going to face, not only Allah tells us you're going to be tested, He warns us, gives us a notification. Like if Sheikh Muhammad says, look, in 1 hour's time there's going to be a fire alarm in this building. We know in 1 hour's time there's going to be a fire alarm. So when the fire alarm comes, what happens? Do we panic? We say, no, it's okay. Sheikh Mohammed said, there's going to be a fire alarm. We don't need to panic. It's just an alarm. It's just a test, right? Allah did the same thing in the Quran. Listen carefully now. Translation of a verse of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this present world, the dunya, is only an illusionary pleasure, facade. You are sure to be tested through your possessions and your persons. You are sure to hear much that is hurtful from those who were given the scripture before you and from those who associate partners with God. If you are steadfast, have sabr, and mindful of God, have taqwa, that is the best course. Now we see something amazing. Allah has given us the warning notification. He first says, look, I'm telling you life is going to be a test, okay? That's why one of the reasons I created to see which of you is best in deeds. He then goes on to say to us, it's okay. This life, this short life is an illusion. It's just a short illusionary pleasure. You will be tested. You are sure to be tested through what? Your possessions and your persons. Means what? The things that are most beloved to us. Our possessions and our persons. And you're going to hear horrible things from people who were given the scripture before you. Isn't this the state of Muslims today? We're being tested with our possessions, with our persons. Do we not reopen the newspaper, turn on the news, walk in the street and hear things people say about us? But we don't need to panic. Because Allah has already told us this is going to happen. He's given us the warning. So now we see two amazing things. He tells us we're going to be tested, because that's one of the purposes of life. He tells us, don't worry, it's just an illusion. It's just a warning alarm. It's not the real thing. The real life is to come. Then he reminds us that, listen, this has happened to somebody before you. If you're going through something, some difficulty, and somebody comes to you and says, you know what, akhi, ukhti, it's okay. Somebody's been through this before you and they made it okay. You have reassurance, right? If you've got some illness, you've got a virus, and the doctor says, but don't worry, Muhammad, it's okay. You know what this virus you have? Other people have had it before you. You're going to be okay. It's reassurance, right? Allah says the same thing in the Quran. Do you suppose, roughly translated, do you suppose that you will enter the garden without encountering what the people before you encountered? They were afflicted with misfortune and hardship, and they were so shaken that even their messenger, look at this, even their messenger, the ones who are appointed by Allah, the ones who have conversations with Allah, even their messenger and the believers with him cried, Mata'a Nasrullah. Where is the help of Allah? Ala inni Nasrullahi Kareeb. Verily the help of Allah is near. Who is talking about?
Other prophets.
Who is talking about is important from a tafsir point of view. But we have to read the Quran as though it's for us. So when we read that even these people were being tested before us, even the messengers and the people with them cried out, where is the help of Allah? Verily the help of Allah is near. Every time you read Surah Baqarah and you hear that, Mata'a Nasrullah. Think of yourself. Isn't there a moment in your life, in your day, when you would wish to say, Mata'a Nasrullah, with tears in your eyes? In the middle of the night, you're calling out, Mata'a Nasrullah, where is the help of Allah? Allahumma Nasrullahi Kareem. Verily, the help of Allah is near. When you hear that, subhanAllah, you should get goosebumps. You have goosebumps in Netherlands? Goosebumps. Huh? Yeah, that one. You get that. Why? Because Allah is saying, don't worry, the help of Allah is near. This is an amazing reassurance for the believer. That no matter what you're going through, no matter what difficulty you have, if you perceive it correctly, and we'll come to how we should perceive it in a moment. If you perceive it correctly, Allah is telling you the help of Allah is near. There are so many promises in the Quran, wallahi. So many promises in the Quran, which if as believers we perceive them correctly, we would spend our days happy. So I said earlier, I'm going to tell you one of the paths to happiness. If you're going through difficulty and Allah, and you remind yourself that Allah tells you, don't worry, verily the help of Allah is near. Doesn't it make you happy? If you recognize that Allah says in the Quran, "Udu'uni astajib lakum," call out to me, I will respond. This should make us happy. That if we make sincere dua to Allah, if we ask Allah for help, Allah is going to help. Allah is not like us, that we make promises and we break them. Allah makes a promise, "Udu'uni astajib lakum," call out to me and I will respond. The promise is sah, true, haq. How he answers is up to him. He's al-Hakim. He knows best. But we have to recognize that Allah is the one who has helped us. So let's look at what we've seen so far. Allah told us the purpose of life is to be tested, to see which of us is best in deeds. Allah tells us, don't worry, it's an illusion, this life. You're going to be tested, but I'm going to give you the solution to get through it. He tells us, don't worry, people before you, even with the messengers, they have the same things. It's okay. You're going to get through this. The help of Allah is near. So he tells us the test is coming. He tells us the solution. Now, our perception of the difficulties we face in life should be different. This is where we have to pause for a moment. If we recognize that all the difficulties in our life are coming from Allah, if we recognize that, and let's pause on that for a moment. Whatever you see in your life, I don't know, your business got burnt to the ground, you have illness, you get divorced, you lose your job. Answer this for me. Who decreed that for you? If you work for a company, there was a building here, Deloitte, right? If you're working for Deloitte and they sack you, who sacked you? Did Deloitte stop your risk? Answer me. Who wrote that for you? Allah. Who wrote the tsunami? Who wrote the thundercloud? Who wrote the illness? Who is writing every moment of our qadr? Allah. We have no option except to believe this. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no power or strength except with Allah. If we believe and we do as part of our iman in the qadr of Allah, the good and the bad thereof, we have to recognize Allah's hand in everything that we do. Allah's hand is in everything that we do. Let me give an example. A young man from the UK. He was engaged to a girl. Okay? Mashallah, girl, not a boy. This is not Amsterdam. He was engaged to a girl. He said, this mashallah, this is my Khadija, he said. This woman is going to be my Khadija. Meaning the love between him and the Rasulullah and Khadija radiallahu anha, this will be my Khadija. Okay, alhamdulillah. Anyway, the engagement broke before the head nikah. He came to me. He said, I need to kill myself. I said, what? He said, I need to kill myself. I said, why do you need to kill yourself? He said, because this was taken from me. This is what I was living for. I said, stop. This was what I was living for. I said, Allah tells us we live to worship Him. I have not created jinn and mankind except to worship Allah alone. The moment you started worshipping almost, if you're saying you live for this, this is worship, right? So this is bad for you, so Allah took it away from you. He said, no, there's no bad in it for me. This was a mistake. I said, stop. This is a mistake. He said, yes, this is a mistake. This was the girl I was meant to marry. I said, stop. I said, don't say these words. He said, why not? I said, because let me translate those words for you. This was a mistake. This was the girl I was meant to marry. And instead she went and married someone else. Who wrote the marriage of this girl to someone else? He said, Allah. Who wrote that she would not marry you? He said, Allah. Who wrote that maybe he has something better for you? He said, Allah. And yet you think it's a mistake? He said, yes. So what you're saying is, and I'm not saying this, I'm saying, look at the perception. Your perception is, Allah, you messed up. Allah, you got this wrong. Allah, look, this is how my life was meant to be. Let me write for you my qadr. I wanted this, this and this. And you gave me this. What's wrong with you? You're doing something wrong. Would any Muslim say this to Allah? But our perceptions say this. Our perceptions, unfortunately, sometimes say, Allah, you messed up. Allah, you got this wrong. I sat in a gathering. A young boy, 17 years old, was killed in the car crash. His parents were very upset. There was a group of young brothers, his friends, all around. They said, please, will you give us some words? Before I could give any words of reassurance about death, they started the talk. They said, oh, he had his whole life ahead of him. This was a tragedy. His life was cut short. This is a cruel world. I said, please stop. They said, why? He would have got married. He would have had this. He would have had that. His life was cut short. I said, please stop. They said, why? Why stop? They had tears. I said, because what you're saying is the one who gives and takes life is Allah, right? We all agree. They said, yes. And Allah decreed every human being's moment of their death 50,000 years before the creation of Adam alayhi salam, right? No one disagrees with this. They said, yes. And now you're saying he cut short. So Allah made a mistake. One brother said, yes. I said, make tawbah straight away. Allah makes no mistakes. He said, but he had his whole life ahead of him. I said, he didn't. Allah wrote for this boy 17 years. May Allah grant him Jannah. But he wrote for him 17 years. Just as he writes for somebody the business burning down. He writes for somebody the divorce. He writes for somebody the marriage. He writes for somebody this. Whatever musibah we have in our life, Allah has written it. And if we trust that Allah is Al-Hakim, Ar-Rahman, Al-Wadud, Al-Kareem, the list goes on. How can we question what Allah is doing for us? So now we see the perception of how Allah treats our lives has to change. No matter what happens. Wallah, if we can reach the level of Rasulullah, happiness is guaranteed. Guaranteed 24 hours a day. Now, let me give you an example. People sometimes when they hear this, they say, oh, so that means I don't have to do anything. As long as I see everything is okay. I said, no. One thing is how you perceive the creation, how you perceive your relationship with Allah. Though no matter what Allah puts in front of you, your perception is, Allah, this is from you. And I'm either going to be patient with it or grateful for it. And we'll come to that in a moment. But in this dunya, we have to take action. We don't just sit back and do nothing and say, well, it's the qadr of Allah, so what can I do? Yes, our iman is that Allah is the one decreeing our qadr, but we take action. Let me give you an example. The best example I can give, when I'm teaching the course on qadr, understanding the iman and the qadr, people say, so we just sit back. I said, no. Let me give you an example that no one can dispute. The Battle of Badr. Before the Battle of Badr, did not the Prophet ﷺ know the outcome? Sheikh? He knew the outcome? He knew the outcome. Allah promised in the Quran, victory, either the caravan or the victory. This is the promise in the Quran, right? So the ayah was revealed before the battle, that Allah has promised him either the caravan or the victory. So Rasulullah knows. The day before, when the Sahaba and him were making shura, a couple of days before, when the Sahaba and him were making shura, and he said, shall we, what do you feel? Shall we go to battle? And they agreed. After they agreed to go, he said, wallahi, I see the grave of Abu Jahl here. And I see the grave of Fulan Fulan here. So he knew in his heart that Allah is with him and they're going to win. But he took action. The night before the Battle of Badr, the mushrikeen had all gone to sleep. The Muslims had all prayed and made dua and all gone to sleep. And yet Rasulullah ﷺ was the only man standing on the plains of Badr with his hands in ibtihal, like this, raised so high, making dua upon dua upon dua to Allah. So much dua did he alayhi salatu wasalam make that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu found him in this state. And he came with tears in his eyes and said, enough. Allah has answered your prayers, enough. And he put his cloak back onto his shoulders. Because this is the situation. He took action. He made dua to Allah. He lined up his soldiers. He did the defenses. He took action. And yet all along, he had tawakkul in Allah. Allah, you're not going to leave us. Even the dua he made, what did he say? He's not saying, oh Allah, I'm afraid tomorrow. No, he said, oh Allah, if this small band of believers is destroyed tomorrow, who will raise your name? This is what Rasulullah did. He was fighting for the sake of Allah. He was living for the sake of Allah. He was upon persistent happiness because he does everything for the sake of Allah. And so too were his companions, because they learnt this, and we can learn this too. We can learn the same thing. that if we recognize that we perceive everything coming from Allah, but we take action according to the Quran and the Sunnah. If we can do this, our questions in life change. I said at the beginning, this guru of leadership is saying, you've got to ask the right questions. So right now, many in our ummah, and maybe myself, I don't say about anyone else, but myself in this room, sometimes things happen to us and we ask the question, why? Why is this happening to me? What have I done to deserve this? How could this be? Instead, now we change our perception. We see Allah's hand in whatever difficulty is coming. The truck runs over my feet and breaks my legs. Oh, why did the truck come? No. Okay, Ya Allah, this is from you. Maybe Allah, you want me to pass a test. Maybe you want to expiate my sins. Maybe if my feet were whole, I would have walked to the casino. Allah knows best why He does what He does for us. Rasulullah said, Allahu khairul mutlaq. Allah is absolute khair. Whatever He writes for us in our qadr is for our good. Whatever He writes for us in our qadr is for our good. Wallahi, we have to believe this. That whatever is in your life, this is why true leaders in Islam are those who recognize that whatever Allah is writing in our life must be for our good. So the questions we should ask now is, Ya Allah, how do I pass the test? Ya Allah, what do I do to get through this? And Allah gives us the answer. In the ayah I mentioned, when He says, the present world is only an illusionary pleasure. You are sure to be tested through your possessions and your persons. And you are sure to hear much that is hurtful from those who were given the scripture before you and those who associate others with God. If you are steadfast, have sabr. And mindful of Allah, have taqwa. This is the best course. There's the solution. Sabr. Taqwa. I'll give you one hadith, which you will already know, all of you. But if you can implement this hadith in your life, wallahi, happiness is yours every single day. Rasulullah said, Ajib al amri al mu'min. Wondrous, strange, amazing is the affair of the believer. In every affair of the believer there is khair, there is good. When something good happens to him, he does shukr to Allah and this is better for him. When something bad happens to him, he does sabr with Allah and this is better for him. لَيْسَ لِأَحْدٍ إِلَّا لِمُؤْمِنٍ. But this is only for the mu'min. There's your solution. Every single day of your life, you will find you are between two states. You either have something good happening to you, whether it's the food that we eat, the shelter we have, the alhamdulillah, the security, whatever. You can find 1 million things in your day which are good. And you do shukr for those things. And here's the interesting thing. When you do shukr for something, Allah increases it for you. If you thank Allah for your rizq, Allah will increase your rizq. If you thank Allah for your Islam and your Iman, Allah will increase your Islam and your Iman. If you thank Allah for the situations we live in, we don't have bombs dropping on our head, Allah will increase the security for you. So whatever good is happening, and wallahi, every human being will find more good in their lives than bad. Then Allah increases it. And when difficulty comes, you have sabr with Allah. And that's not too difficult, if you think about it. If you recognize the difficulty is coming from Allah in the first place, it's not too hard to be patient, to have sabr. The problem is our perception is not that it's from Allah. I'm not saying us in this room. Maybe some of us. The problem is we see things and we don't see Allah's hand in it. The glass breaks, we blame ourselves, we blame each other. We don't see Allah's hand even in the glass breaking. Aisha radiallahu anha said that if one of your shoelaces were to break, make dua to Allah to grant you tawfiq to fix your shoelace. How many of us make dua for a shoelace? She saw something we didn't see. She saw Allah's hand even in the shoelace. We see Allah's hand only in the big things. We forget that every single moment of our lives is being controlled by Allah. So that hadith, if we can move between a state of sabr and a state of shukr, constantly recognizing, these are the only two states I need to be in. Because either something good is happening or something bad is happening. If I recognize, okay, there's something good. Allah has given me a glass of water here. I'm thirsty. Alhamdulillah, we do shukr for this. Some musibah is going on in my life. That's equally from Allah as the water is from Allah. I do sabr with this. Now inshallah, we can get to happiness. So to conclude, I want to finish on that hadith, that we recognize sabr and shukr are the two states that we move between. And if we are able to change our perception, this is what I took away from this leadership conference, brothers and sisters. This man spent his life coming back to Islam and doesn't even know he's come back to Islam. 24 years of study brought him back to a conclusion that we've brought to get today from what? From verses of Quran and hadith of Rasulullah SAW. So if we can recognize that we just change our perceptions, then inshallah, happiness and leadership, good leadership, will be ours to be had.